वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला. आई एम डॉक्टर अपर्णा वाटवे, फैकल्टी ऑफ टाटा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ सोशल साइंसेस. इन दिस मॉड्यूल आई विल टॉक अबाउट कॉमन प्रॉपर्टी रिसोर्सेज एंड इंट्रोड्यूस द कॉन्सेप्ट्स. दिस इज पार्ट ऑफ एनवायरनमेंट एंड सोसाइटी पेपर. इन दिस मॉड्यूल आई विल इंट्रोड्यूस द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी, द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ ओनरशिप, डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ राइट्स एंड यूजर्स. I will also talk about example of common property resources and different kinds of ownership patterns which are seen in India. At the end, we will talk about tragedy of commons, an idea of Garrett Hardin. We all require natural resources for living. It is necessary to be able to use, access, and manage natural resources to get their products. The ownership of resources is very important because it allows one to use them over generations. The idea of property and idea of ownership were significant part of cultural development of humans. In today's world, private ownership of resources is the most desired and widely promoted. Adam Smith, a pioneer of political economy, has discussed the ideas of property and ownership. Capitalism's central assumption is property rights are necessary to encourage their holders to develop the property, generate wealth, and efficiently allocate resources based on the operation of markets. Focus has always been more on the private ownership. Land is a resource which can be easily owned as a resource. But other natural resources like wind, air, sunlight, forest and biodiversity do not easily fit into the idea of property. They cannot be owned like land. So how have humans used these natural resources? Answers can be found in the natural resource management practices of local communities. These natural resources were owned collectively and treated as common property resources. Common property resources are defined as non-exclusive resources to which rights of use are distributed among a number of co-owners, generally identified by their membership in a community. Pioneering studies in this subject were conducted by Elinor Ostrom and her colleagues. She has won Nobel Prize in economics. Various types of common property resources are seen in natural resource management. The examples of common property resources are common grazing lands in the villages, ponds, rivers and beaches which are used by people in the village, the threshing grounds where different kinds of agricultural practices are done are also common lands. Community forests are also present in many areas. These areas are sometimes owned by individuals or groups, but the decisions and the rules about use are done collectively. They are done by the entire community. They are also enforced through cultural practices. Conflicts are resolved through community decision making. Natural resource management includes rules which give different rights of use and management to individuals and to groups. For example, individuals can fish in the village pond, but the days on which fishing will be allowed or not allowed are decided by the entire village. In 1992, Schlager and Ostrom identified different types of rights. Access is the right to enter a defined physical property. For example, a person can go to a village forest. Withdrawal is the right to obtain the products of a resource. A grazer can go into the forest and collect fodder. A tribal can go into the forest and collect non-timber forest produce for his or her own use. That is the right of withdrawal. Management is the right to regulate internal use patterns and transform the resource by making improvements. Exclusion is the right to determine who will have an access right and how that right may be transferred. Alienation is the last and most important of the rights. It is the right to sell or lease either or both of the above collective choice rights. For every right an individual holds, rules exist that authorize or require particular actions in exercising that property rights. The rule may be about how much of the resource can be used and when. All rights have complementary duties. This ensures that individuals continue to take care of the resource. To possess a right means others have the duty to protect that right. Members of a community will know rights of each of the members and they will have to respect them. Transfer of rights is generally through inheritance patterns which are decided by culture. McKean in 1995 stated that common property is a way of privatizing the rights to use a resource without having to divide the resource into individual holdings. Common property gives resource owners the incentive to manage their resources sustainably. Using this concept of rights, Schlager and Ostrom divided the natural resource users into four categories. The first of this is the category of authorized users. These are people who have only access and withdrawal rights. The next are claimants who have access and withdrawal rights and also the right of management. Proprietors is a group of people who have the right of exclusion in addition to the other two. And owner is the highest category who holds the right of alienation, exclusion, management, and can make decisions about access and withdrawal. The rights of authorized users are defined by others who hold collective choice rights of management and exclusion. Fishermen and grazers can do their practices in the village provided that the local authority allows them to use it. Claimants have the collective choice authority to devise rights of withdrawals. Example of this is the Joint Forest Management Committee. The people in this committee can decide how much of non-timber forest produce or fruits or fodder can be harvested from a forest area. Proprietors possess collective choice rights to participate in management and exclusion. They can authorize access to resources. A good example of this is village panchayat. A village panchayat can stop outsiders from taking resources or using the lands in their village. Owners hold all rights and also the right of alienation. They can sell or lease the collective choice rights. This highest of rights gives lot of responsibility also to the owners. The government has the right to make decisions about any of the rights above and is an example of the ultimate owner. In reality, there are many variations and we can make many subcategories within these five categories. For the purpose of regulating the use and management of common property resources, there must be institutions. These institutions authorize and secure use by a group of users. They also set the rules to govern this use and monitor as well as enforce them. In the module so far, we have looked at different types of rights, different categories of users, and the nature of their rights. Common property systems can function only if the group is organized or has the ability to organize itself to implement the rules. It is also a mechanism by which they can negotiate with state and other external entities. An example of this is seen in Northeast India. The village councils are the supreme decision makers about the village lands. They can negotiate with the state government and also with the national government because they have separate rights on communal lands, which are tribal lands. Some traditional systems of resource use are based on caste or community. They have inherent inequalities in them. In many villages in India, the river or pond is divided into sectors. Some sectors are accessed by upper class, upper caste, and some sectors are accessed only by the lower caste or poorer households. In this system, Some individuals may be enjoying more rights and more privileges due to the cultural factors. They gain these through caste, class, or gender, which is part of the Indian society. We also need to understand a little bit about the nature of rights. De facto rights are rights which are decided by facts alone. That means they are decided by resource users themselves, and they also have made the rules to enforce them. These are respected and followed by the members of the community, but they are often unrecognized by the outsiders. They are not written, but they are very well known through cultural practices. Many of the natural resource rights were, and even today are, de facto, that is, by facts alone. In contrast to this, de jure rights are written. They are legal. They are made by law, generally by the government. Rights are recognized by the government and they are granted to the resource user. De jure rights are protected by the court of law. But they may not be very well known to the communities. Land and water in India are mainly governed by de jure rights. But the laws are not so clear about the other natural resources. One may have de facto rights of use, but not have the de jure rights unless they are recognized. A classic case of this is of tribals in India. Tribals were managing their land and forest only through de facto rights. They all knew about these rights. But when the forest laws came into existence, they lost all the de facto rights because they were not recognized by the law. In today's world, de facto rights need to be also recognized and converted into de jure rights. Otherwise, they will not be respected by others outside the community. There is a difference between common property and common pool resources. Common property defines an institutional arrangement. It confers a set of people with a bundle of rights. Common pool, on the other hand, refers to a class of resources which cannot be managed as private property. These are characterized as resources which are difficult to manage. Air is a good example of it. Underground water sources, oils, aquifer are all common pool resources. Common property resources also differ from what are known as open access resources. Common property refers to situations where access is limited to a specific group that holds the rights in common. Open access may not have a defined group of users. Therefore, it lacks a set of rules that governs its use. These are the kind of resources which are often overused. In 1968, Garrett Hardin, a biologist, wrote a paper titled Tragedy of Commons. He argued that common resource use leads invariably to degradation. According to him, individuals always make selfish choices. He talked about the finiteness of global resources and concluded that there is a need to self-regulate the resource use. Hardin believed that this can be possible only through private ownership or strict government control over all resources. In his paper, Hardin gave one example, which was a theoretical example. He described a situation in British grazing lands, which are known as commons. He said, if a grazing land is being grazed by different herdsmen, each of the herdsmen will be interested in increasing his own number of animals because it gives him increased profits. Now, if all the herdsmen think in the same way and each increases his animals, at the end of it, the entire common land will be degraded because there will be too many animals which are grazing on it. Maximizing grazing in due course will deplete and destroy commons. the gains for individuals offset the share of the loss of each individual. But at the end of it, each and every one of them will suffer the same loss. Hardin compared this to the classic Greek tragedy, in which one knows that the chain of events is going to lead to sad condition at the end. And therefore, he called it the tragedy of the commons. This paper had a long-lasting impact in many parts of the world. It changed the way people think about common resources. It had an impact on policy and practice related to natural resources. His paper, in some cases, was misunderstood or misquoted. Common property resources were considered as always prone to overexploitation. A lot of other scientists, researchers, and activists urged to privatize or naturalize all the natural resources because they believed that the common use will lead to degradation. It promoted land distribution policies that favor individual private land holdings. In some cases, it justified the state control over natural resources like forest. Ostrom and her colleagues criticized Harding severely. According to them, he was failing to understand the complexity of regulated commons. His example was theoretical and limited to resource which was used openly and not commonly as per the definition. Hardin had generalized based on limited observations, and he had failed to take account of a vast body of knowledge regarding how communities manage. He did not realize that communities in many cases self-regulate. They work towards common good and not towards private gains as in other cases. Many continue to promote private ownership rather than understanding the advantages of common ownership over resources. Privatization or government control have become very common. In case of India, colonization accelerated this process. Many de jure rights were created without taking cognizance of the de facto rights. There were severe conflicts between the tribals, local people, and other livelihood practitioners and the British government for control over forest, land, and water. The colonial laws created during the British period continue even today. Because of these laws, ownership of land has become of supreme importance. All the other resources like water, crops, and forests are bound to the land. If you own the land, you own the water, the trees, or any other resource on that land. This system does not recognize that the owners and users could be very different. This is the way in which government gained supreme control over all resources. Today, Indian government is the biggest landowner of the country and also has the decision-making power to control all the resources on Indian land. The state is often incapable of managing or preventing degradation of the resources it owns. One can see it from the state of rivers and forests in India. Individual use can also lead to degradation, especially in areas where the productivity is less. Privatization is not likely to improve the efficiency of resource use, but it gives interest for the people to lead towards resource use. In fact, in some cases, it is likely to worsen the problems of those who do not have ownership and have no access to private property. This includes many marginal communities, tribals, nomadic groups, and women, because they do not have cultural ownership of the resources. It is difficult to say which is the best form of property ownership. In some cases, private ownership might work best. In other cases, state control would be necessary to regulate the resource use. There could be cases in which community would be the best decision maker in resource use. There is no single answer to all this. One size cannot fit all. Ideally, all three types of ownerships can be combined and they can be together and help to regulate each other. In this module, we looked at some of the most important concepts, terminologies, and definitions in the common property resources. We learned about different types of rights and different types of users who hold those rights. In the end, we looked at tragedy of commons and the implications of it on policy. We tried to compare private, government, and common ownership and came to the conclusion that there can be no single answer to what ownership is the best. I hope you were interested in this topic. You can take a look at e-text, which gives details of many of the terminologies and concepts in the module. You can also look at essential readings, which gives the key papers mentioned in this topic. Hope you stay with us for the next session. Thank you.